Oh, good evening, Norman. What a super day I've had, have you? Oh, yes, yes. Fresh air. Company of my peers, eh? Success at sport. Fantastic day. Oh, and if you were buying a drink, mine's a pint of bitter.
I wasn't.
Oh, dear.
Pint of bitter, please, precious.
Right.
Oh, just a friendly expression, Squire, not a term of endearment.
Glad to hear it, son.
Actually, today, I have been running better bites.
Oh. Do I detect a note of criticism in that statement, Norman? I, too, have been running better bites, you know.
On a golf course? Come off it.
Oh, no, no, no. More important decisions made on the golf course than any boredom, Norman. That is common knowledge, huh?
Perpetuated by lazy bosses with too much time on their hands.
Oh. I thought we had got rid of your insurrectionist phase, Norman. As I think I've told you before, we're not comrades at better bites, you know. We are colleagues.
Here we are.
Thank you. Shouldn't that husband of yours be muzzled, though?
Should I suggest it to you?
No, no. Just a little joke, a little vixen.
Reg Holdsworth, a man who drinks deep from the cup of life, as he would no doubt say. A man with an eye for the ladies and a ready smile. Hello and welcome to a special Coronation Street video which takes a close look at the life and loves of Reg Holdsworth. Reg entered street life in late 1989 as manager of Better Buy supermarket. He held court at the store and found it an ideal place to let Cupid lead him to a lonely lady. And it wasn't long before his eyes set on Rita Fairclough.
Well, 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 Mrs. Fairclough.
Hello there.
Oh, what a great surprise it is to find you browsing amongst our humble wares.
Well, you're as cheap as anybody.
Well, I hope that's our humble wares you were referring to. Now, these I can recommend. Mm-hmm. A bit out of the ordinary, like yourself, but very wholesome.
Like myself.
Yes. And, of course, it's a thing you can eat on its own, put it that way.
Like myself again. I mean, I often eat on my own.
Really? Well, I'm sure it must be a matter of choice. But try them anyway.
Thank you.
Well, what I'm saying is, no names, no pack jokes, you understand?
Go on.
Suppose somebody was to send you, out of the blue, so to speak, on a whim, a bouquet of flowers.
Oh, I love flowers.
Somebody who you'd never seen in a romantic light before. Somebody mature, but with a spring in the step, and a sense of humour. And somebody in whose eyes the light of love still twinkled.
Go on.
And with these flowers comes an invitation to a dance. How would your reaction be, as a woman of the world, so to speak?
Chewing out, Miss Fella. Cheeky monkey. Mind you, Jack, you know, he'd kill you if he fell down.
No, no, not you, you silly woman. I'm talking about Rita Fairclough. God. You know, it occurs to me that all these people that go jogging and all that, they'd do themselves a lot more good and a lot less harm if they went dancing.
I dare say. Well, excuse me.
Mrs. Duckworth, would you like to return this to its rightful place? Whilst you're on your way to wherever you're going.
Hey, I don't believe it. It's everywhere.
I mean, take Fred Astaire. Now, he must have been the fittest man on the planet, but there was nothing overdeveloped, nothing bulging about him.
No, except his wallet and top of his head. But you're right, he was fit.
I mean, it's not the reason why you go, but there's the pleasure of conversation. It's not the reason why you go, but it's all part of it.
Yeah, do you know, I never thought about that. You're right. Thought.
Yeah, so it is, yeah. It's long been my view that ballroom dancing is a very bastion of civilization.
Well, I've a feeling civilization is doomed. There's not a lot of us about.
Oh, well, then we must fight the good fight, Mrs. Fairclough. And if you'd like to go dancing again, I'd be very conscious of the privilege.
Well, how very nice, Mr. Holdsworth. I don't see why not.
Do you know something? This is the last chance I'll have of partnering Ginger Rogers, because you are, you know, you're a dead ring.
Well, look, if you're passing, we must arrange something, but I'll have to consult my diary, of course.
It'll be a pleasure, Mrs.
Ginger Rogers. Cheers.
Do you know what I'd like to do tomorrow, Rita?
No, what?
Go AWOL and play truant.
Wouldn't Better Buys just crumble to dust if you went missing?
Probably,
but the batteries need recharging, and where better to recharge them than a racecourse?
Hey, I didn't know you were into racing.
Oh, yes, yes. The royal family and I have long shared an interest in racing. Would you like to come with me, Rita?
Oh, sorry, I can't. I have too much to do tomorrow.
Huh? Oh, well, some other time, then.
Yeah, I'd love to. Do you know, I've never actually been on a racecourse.
Oh, you don't know what you're missing. Very colourful scene is a racecourse, you know. Some very colourful characters. Actually, I find that the main attraction, studying them, you know.
Really?
Mm. I think we'd cut quite a dash, you and me, in the paddock. Lord Holdsworth and the Duchess, casting expert eyes over their filly.
Oh, so that's why you go, is it?
Yes, and I can guarantee you'd meet some very interesting people. It's very well known, you know, in turfing circles, is Reg Holdsworth, as the Argo Can will tell you.
Oh, I look forward to it, then.
Mm. Do you know, you can tell a lady lives here.
Well, I hope so.
It's got the woman's touch. It's long been missing from my house, I can tell you. Not that there was all that much ever. She's got some very masculine tendencies, my wife, you know. She'd tell you herself she'd have loved to play at rugby league.
Oh, where is she?
New Zealand.
New Zealand?
Mm, living with her sister.
That's a long way.
I thought that when she went.
Veronica? I thought you got lost.
Got stopped by customs on top of everything else. They went through every single little thing. It was humiliating. I mean, do I look like a smuggler?
Well, no, of course not, dear. Was it a good flight?
Long.
Yes, yes, well, it would be from New Zealand. Mind you, I was taken aback when your sister rang and said you were going to arrive today. It was quite a sudden change of plan.
Well, I'm very sorry if it inconvenienced you.
No, not at all, dear, not at all. Delighted to have you back. The sooner the better. Only, Eileen did sound a trifle abrupt on the phone, I thought. Not her usual self.
Really?
Yes. Oh, well, perhaps I'm imagining it. Right, well, what we need to do now is get you warm, hot bath, good old English cuppa, see if we can cure the jolly old jet lag. Right.
Hillside Road, driver, please. My lady wife would be obliged if you'll keep your foot down. She's just jetted in from the Antipodes.
Not Hillside Road. Take us to Coronation Street, Weatherfield.
Where?
Well, that's where the cabin is, I believe. The little shop your lady friend runs. Coronation Street, Weatherfield. But don't stand there like limp lettuce, Reg. Get in.
Veronica! Oh. Veronica! I order you to get back into this cab! Oh, a very, very headstrong woman.
That'll be £9.50.
£9.50? We've only come from Manchester Airport, you know, not Heathrow.
£9.50! I ought to charge you another fiver for the damage you're doing to my eardrums.
Hang on a minute. I'm not Mrs. Fairclough.
Not guilty either.
These are a bit shop soiled,
right,
Deirdre, but
you're
you can
Mrs. Fairclough, aren't you?
Yes. Who are you?
I'm his wife. And according to my information, you're his latest fancy piece, which gives us rather a lot to talk about, wouldn't you say?
Now, just hang on a minute.
Veronica. She's a bit overwrought. It's jet lag. You see, it's a 10,000-mile flight from New Zealand, and she probably hasn't slept for 24 hours, plus a zeal, you know.
You're not going to deny it, are you?
I'm not going to do anything except tell you to get the hell out of my shop.
I don't know what you've landed yourself into,
do you? Mean landed myself into?
How I know he's been sniffing around here. I've had a friend keeping an eye on him while I've been in New Zealand. Not that I need have bothered. I've known him be up two streets in the back garden with our next door neighbour while I was cleaning the front windows.
Now, that has to be a lie, hasn't it? I mean, you see, her metabolism's on the blink.
Yes, well, her head will be on the blink if she doesn't leave my shop.
Oh, don't worry, I'm going. Back to New Zealand, as it happens, just as soon as I've attended to a few matters here, like selling the house.
Eh?
Oh, didn't I tell you, Reg? I've met another man over there. A proper man, not a jumped-up little shop assistant like you. That's what he was, you know, when we met. And who kicked him up the better by ladder? Yours truly. Though we'll give him his due. He did contribute the flannel. He's great on flannel, is Reg. Flannel you into bed, did he?
Hey, no, that is quite enough, Veronica, really.
Look,
I'm sorry,
are you leaving?
You know, you're the first of his many lady friends I've managed to corner. Still, Flannelers do have to be slippery sods, don't they?
Have you no dignity, Veronica?
Not a scrap, Reg. Oh. Well, I can't have, can I, stopping with you all these years. Still, it's done me good coming here, getting some of the anger off my chest. No, I won't flatter him. Not anger. Contempt. So I owe you a favour, Mrs. Fairclough.
A favour?
Well, if I'm going back to New Zealand, which I am, I've really not got a lot of use for old Pumpkin Face here, have I? He's redundant to my future. So you can have him, love. Though I warn you, he could do with a new engine. That's if you didn't know that already. I'm off now. Cheerio!
She doesn't know what she's saying, Rita. When she's had a lie down, she'll be a different sort of woman. 24 hours, she won't know what's happening. I'll be in touch.
Don't bother. I don't want to see you or your flaming wife in this shop ever again.
Now, we shouldn't sink down to her level, Rita. That shows a definite lack of...
Get out! What do you two want?
That packet of envelopes you've got in your hand.
4/4 mint humbugs, please.
Rita thought she'd seen the last of Reg. Imagine her horror when she discovered who was moving into the flat above the cabin. Rita was also to discover that as far as Reg was concerned, she was still the woman for him.
Number 12?
Round the corner, love. Not you moving in, is it?
Oh, he's following on behind. Oh, here he comes. His name's Holdsworth. Been any breakages, have they?
No, I hope not.
Moved an old lady last week. She had 170 pieces of china. Didn't crack a single one.
Oh, very lucky.
Well, you employ us, you're dealing with professionals. That's what you pay for. Very nice. Cut glass, is it?
Yes, it is, yes. The staff at my last branch gave me that. Had a whip round in appreciation when I left. I'll take it from you, Chris.
I'll not drop it. Well, that's what you're paying for.
Yes. Here. Why don't you have a drink on me? Cheers. And, tell you what, I'll pick your brains before you leave, if you don't mind. I suppose in your line of work, you see the insides of more bachelor flats than most. Tell me, are futons still de rigueur?
You what?
Well, it's a miss, isn't it? Cleared me out. Even took the matrimonial bed, the swine. Oh, yes. Tell you, I won't be doing this for long. You know, we spend a third of our lives in bed. I mean, why put up a second best? Well, not me. You come round here in 2 weeks. Mate, just like Tom Jones's boudoir, aren't you? Oh, anyway, what are you doing today then, Rita?
Well, I shall be stood behind here till dinner time, and then not a lot, really.
Oh, you're not one for striding out into the countryside, are you?
No. I once went on a nature trip from school and fell in a patch of nettles. I think that put me off.
Right. Well, I'm contemplating a day of rest.
Yes,
after yesterday. It's our busiest day, you know.
Well, it would be.
Oh, yes. Aisles were thronged. Stacked trolleys as far as the eye could see.
Really?
Yes, so I thought today, right, rest and recuperation.
Yes,
a little stroll, modest lunch, hope the rain keeps off.
Yes.
And then I wondered if you'd like to join me for a drink this evening, about 7:30-ish.
Well, I'm not just sure, you see.
It's only a little neighbourly get-together, you know. I suppose you could call it a flat warming, really.
Yes.
It's just to set the seal of approval on me moving in, that's all it is.
Yes, well,
I'd be very happy if you could.
Right, OK, thank you. Be very nice.
That's wonderful. Yes. I'll see you tonight, then. How's things?
Oh, fine.
You OK? Great.
Yeah,
bye.
Thanks.
Bye.
Now, why didn't he invite you? Or has he already invited you?
Invite me to what?
Rita, come in.
I brought my friend. You don't mind, dear?
Of course he doesn't.
Only, I got the impression it was the more the merrier type of party.
Oh, the more definitely merrier, yes. Right, sit down then. Make yourselves at home. Of course, it's not really home as yet. There's still some way to go as far as the decorations and decor are concerned.
Very tidy, though, Reg. I bet you're a very tidy sort of man, aren't you?
Yes. Well, I do prefer order to chaos.
So do I. Are we the first here, then?
First, yes. And at last, actually. No, I've chosen the wrong night.
People can't come for one reason or another.
Shame, shame. Still, we're here.
Yes, you are. Yes, and I'm delighted to see you, both of you.
You see, I told you you wouldn't mind. I had to force her to bring me.
Really? Well, I'm glad you did. I'm very, very glad. Yes. And of course, I would have asked you, but... Well...
You thought I'd be working.
Absolutely. Right, I'll get us some drink, shall I, then?
Wouldn't be a bad idea.
Just help yourself to the...
Oh, right. You were. You haven't invited anybody. Never had any intention.
Nobody objects to champagne, I hope.
Well, what do you think, Rita?
I sometimes get a bit bored with this.
Don't we all? Go on then, Cock, if you've no tells.
Yes, better by as best as this.
Oh, well then.
Do you know, Reg was saying they were run off the feet yesterday.
Were they really?
Trolleys everywhere.
I can imagine. Still, he looks like the kind of man who would take it all in his stride. Does it never worry you, Reg, all that responsibility?
No, not unduly. In fact, I think I could be said to thrive on it.
Well, you certainly look to be thriving on summit. Don't you think, Rita?
Oh, I do.
Right, shall we raise our glasses then, ladies?
Thank you. We're very good at that.
Aren't you going to have a drink?
Oh, how silly of me. Excuse me.
Don't you dare go without me, lady.
Are you sure you don't want me to bring you anything?
No, you're all right, love. I've got a sandwich.
Rita?
Hello.
Well, what do I see here? Sweeties and jelly babies and all sorts.
Right, well, I'll be off then.
Oh, hang on a minute.
All of which put me in mind of a certain verse.
Do they?
Rita, will you let go of me slip?
Yes, a very affectionate verse which the postman delivered to me this morning.
Oh, aye. And are you as keen on him as well?
Yes, we mustn't admit to these things, must we? We who worship at the shrine of Saint Valentine.
Look, is there something you want?
Yes, I wondered if you fancied a little luncheon.
No, I can't, I'm sorry.
Oh, well, another time then. If I was sweet on you, would you be my jelly baby?
You sent him a card?
No. No, I did not, I swear.
Well, he seems to think he did.
I don't care what he thinks. I swear to you, Mavis, I did not send Reg Holdsworth a Valentine's card.
If I were sweet on you, would you be my jelly baby?
You were.
All right, Bet. What do you want? A pint?
Yes.
A pint, Bet, and another vodka in there, love. Now, Reg. I don't want to offend you, but there's something I have to say to you. And you've got to listen, and you've got to believe me.
Another cryptic message?
No. This'll be as clear as day. You think I sent you a Valentine, don't you?
Yes, because if not you, then who?
I don't know who, but not me, no. I'm sorry about that, but that's the way it is.
Well, I know it wasn't signed, but it certainly
seemed. I don't care. It weren't me.
Are you sure you're not too shy to confess?
No. I'm not a bit shy, actually. Never have been. But if you want you and me to be on speaking terms, you can burn that card, do what you want with it. As long as you understand, it weren't from me.
Oh. All right, then, point taken.
Well, glad about that.
Well, you're still my beating heart.
When the brewery told Bet to prepare a pub quiz, who else could she turn to organise the event? Who had the skills, the finesse, the personality?
Is this all right, Mr. Holdsworth?
Yes, that's wonderful, that Raquel. Marvellous, yes. Can I give you a handout, my dear?
I can manage, thanks.
Wait, do you want me to turn these lights on for you now, or what?
Well, just a moment. I'm trying to imagine the whole thing. Right. What I want? The two team's chairs arranged towards the banner in a chevron.
No what?
A chevron, sort of V-shape, like flying ducks. And I want the quizmaster table and chair right in the middle. Have you got that? Right. Mrs. Gilroy.
Oh, ducks flew in a line.
Yeah.
Doing folks what?
What's up with you now?
Well, you're just about to have the grand opening, so to speak. I thought you'd like to be the first to witness it.
Oh, I can't wait.
I know, it's exciting, isn't it? I've often thought I should be in show business.
Is that a fact?
Yes. Smell of the grease paint, the roar of the crowd, a little bit of the barn in me. Yes, I'm a real showman. In fact, if I hadn't been enticed by the blandishments of the retail trade, I think I would.
Hey, don't we switch the lights on for you now?
I think so, Jack. We are ready. my little piece de resistance.
Voila.
Oh.
Oh, very Las Vegas.
What did I promise you, Mrs. Gilroy? Did I not do it? And who knows, after tonight?
Yes.
Well, I have several other little adventures in embryo. This could be the start of a real partnership.
Good evening and welcome to the Rover's Return quiz contest. Find a team to enter the Newton and Ridley Super Quiz Challenge Trophy.
Oh, oh, testing, testing. Oh, Mike's dead.
I don't even know he was ill.
Oh, well. These things happen in show business, don't they? But the show must go on, as they say. Yes, right. No, well, all right. The rules are, in actual fact, very simple. Have you got a rule sheet there?
Well, I haven't got it, no.
Well, there are two halves, and the first four rounds in each half, of course, are team rounds. Now, conferring is allowed, apart from individual questions, and only the captains of each team, voila, can answer. And all decisions, as quizmaster, are, of course, final and
money.
Right. How about, can't we answer?
No, only in the individual round, I think.
Well, what does that mean?
Yes, well, everything will make itself clear, Mrs. Duckworth, if you allow me to continue.
Oh, I'm confused already, mate.
Oh, yes, and our score this evening will be kept by the lovely and the ravishing Raquel.
Without further ado, the
first question goes to the gentleman's team, right, your starter for two. Ready? What colour is the aeroplane of the German fighter ace, the Red Baron?
Well, that's easy. It's red, isn't it?
No, 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 it's too easy. It's a trick question.
No, it's red.
No, it's a catch question. Come on, what colour is it?
It's red.
White.
No, it's red.
I'll have to hear you.
It's to match the clouds. It's red.
Your answer, gentlemen, please.
All right. White.
Sorry, the answer is, of course, red.
Hey, shut up, you're on our side.
Gentlemen, your next question. Right, come on. What is ESP?
Racehorse won the derby.
Sorry. ESP is extrasensory perception. No point.
Captain.
No, exactly. He shouldn't have called out.
Well, that's your fault.
ESP were a racehorse.
No, you should ask us another question.
You might know that one.
We knew the last one. Yes, we did.
Gentlemen, ladies, please, can we have a bit of order?
Well, I think we should stick to the rules.
Right.
So we should ask us another question.
You should have answered through your captain.
We tried.
The rules.
Yeah, but Red shouldn't have accepted Jack's answer.
Gentlemen, ladies.
Rules are rules, Martin.
We should be asked another question.
Yeah.
Look, can we have a ruling on this?
Yeah, come on.
Yes, if we can find a rule, baby. Yes,
question. I'm not playing.
Yeah, well, you forfeit the game then, don't you? You can't play it.
This powerful leader of men was, of course, seen at his best in Better Buys. Reg had been the captain of this particular ship for some time, and he was always keen to give Curly the tuition he needed to turn him into a business giant like himself. When Christmas came around, a time not only known as the season of mellow fruitfulness, but also the season of vast turnover and profit, it wasn't surprising that Better Buys needed the steadying hand of Reg at the helm.
Mr. Holdsworth, what's the problem?
Well, there isn't a problem as such, Norman. If there had been, I would have solved it, wouldn't I? Personally, as is my wont with problems.
All right, what's the trouble then? You don't mind if I call it trouble, do you? Or snag, perhaps. Minor, of course.
Santa's dead.
You what?
He's dead. Deceased. Ceased to function.
Well, it's not exactly a problem for us, but it certainly is for poor old Cyril Marsden. When did this happen?
Last night. According to his wife, she found him in the chair watching a Raquel Welch film. Only wasn't watching it, if you see what I mean.
You know, it's not a bad way to go. So you need a new Santa for the fairy grotto?
Not me, Norman, you. From the moment of Cyril's demise, you are, I see, in charge of Santa Claus for this store. There you are.
But I thought you enjoyed organising the fairy grotto. I saw you last year.
slip in your list of prezzies to poor old Cyril?
Yes, and he must have forgotten it, because I got a pair of dark brown socks from Miss Boothroyd on the cheese counter, didn't I?
Right, right. I shall find a replacement Santa.
Just one moment. I thought we might go a bit upmarket this year, Norman. I mean, Cyril was all right, but he got a bit pungent if he got within 10 yards of him. And I've heard more than one child asking his mother if Santa went into the same pub as Daddy.
So you need a new Santa who's clean in his habits and speaks like Roger Moore.
Spot on. You see, that's a much better image for Better Buy than some old retrobate who stank of snuff and best bitter, God rest his soul.
Don't you fancy the job yourself?
Don't be ridiculous, Norman. Hey, I'm much too young.
Right, I'll see what I can do.
Right.
Ho, ho, ho,
just had
ho.
A very distressing experience, Norman, lad.
Oh, you haven't been run over by Mad Jack and his trolley again, have you? You know, we're really going to have to do something about him. He zooms around this store all day for hours on end with nothing in his trolley except a set of pilchards.
Hey, I've just been assaulted by a feminist.
Oh, very nasty.
This woman, an enormous woman, responded to your card in the foyer, she said, inviting applications for the post of Santa Claus.
Santa Claus is a fella.
Well, that's what I said. And she said, how do you know? Well, I was explaining the story of St. Nicholas. And then she said, I suppose you're one of these men who insist that God was a male. Well, I certainly do, Norman, don't you?
Well, I
got my dander up, but well and truly, I can tell you. I said, as far as I can see, madam, the feminist movement has simply resulted in women adopting many of men's vices. Using my very best round vowels, as I do, Norman. Bad habits such as smoking too much, drinking too much, and driving motor cars at excessive speeds. And then she went and clocked me with a bunch of spring onions she was holding.
Not a bad idea, though.
What?
You know, having a female Santa, you know, a curvaceous model-type Santa would be a great gimmick.
Curvaceous model-type Santa, eh? No, no, definitely not. It's a traditional story, this here. We need a traditional male Santa, don't we?
Right.
Mind you, I know what you mean. Shorty red cloak, high heels, provocative pose.
Yeah, all right, Reg.
Ah, Mr. Aldred.
Mr. Sugden, I really must protest.
About what?
I have just had a complaint from a customer, a long-standing customer, mind, that you have sent away her little boy with a flea in his ear.
A well-made little lad with red hair.
Yes, that is the one, yes.
He was lucky he went away with just a flea in his ear after the mouthful he gave me.
Mr. Sugden, I really must protest because this is not the first time it's happened.
And it won't be the last one either if I get any more like ginger nut.
That is where you are wrong, Mr. Sugden. You are not being paid to moralise to our customers and their offspring.
I see. Well, it's obvious to me the spirit of Christmas means something entirely different to you than it does to me.
Yes, that would appear to be the case. But since it happens to be me who is employing you, I think that gives me a say in the way that you carry out your duties. Don't you agree?
I see. Well, it leaves me no choice then, does it? If you're not happy with the way I'm doing my job, I think it'd be better all round if you found yourself somebody else. So I'm off. There you are. Do it yourself.
Mr. Watts, as manager of this store, I tell you what your duties are. You do not tell me.
I accept that, Mr. Holdsworth, but you wouldn't expect me to drive one of our articulated lorries to the Grappinor branch, because I would be eminently unsuitable and unqualified to do the job. And the same goes for Santa Claus.
Look, Mr. Holdsworth, Somebody has got to do something about that grotto before somebody gets hurt. I mean, the kids are running around like demons and the customers are complaining.
Hey, I thought you were supposed to be giving me Anna stuck in them shows.
I am. I'm just telling Mr. Holdsworth, somebody's got to do something about that grotto.
Well, it's obvious, isn't it? If Percy Sugden can't do it, we'll have to get somebody else to do it, won't we?
Yes, thank you, Mrs. Duckworth. We have come to that conclusion without your help. The only problem seems to be now who that could be.
Clearly. You don't even look the part.
Yes, well, we don't actually have anybody who does look like the part, Mrs. Duckworth.
Well, we didn't have anyone who looked the part of Backers, did we? So you showed us the way.
Oh, no, no. And if you think I'm going in that grotto,
yeah,
you can think
Mr.
you're going
to... Oh, yeah, Mr. Holdsworth, you'd be great. I mean, Curly is right. I mean, you were great, weren't you? You know, when we had that... Oh, I mean, people around here, they're still talking about your Backers.
Really?
Yeah.
Did you hear that, Mr. Watts?
Yes, I did, Mr. Holdsworth, and I quite agree. I remember thinking at the time, what a pity it is that the carnival only comes round once a year and there wasn't more opportunity for you to display your obvious talent in that direction.
Yeah. No, it wouldn't work. No, definitely not. No.
Oh,
well, somebody's going to have to do something before they tear the place apart, Mr. Holdsworth.
Well, you certainly seem to know what you want for Christmas, don't you? Yes. Yes, it might have been quicker if you'd written down what you don't want. Ho, 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 ho. Right.
Here we go. Off you go, then. Have a good Christmas. Jolly, jolly. Oh, toys and games round to the right, madam, for you. Yes. Oh, hello there.
Ho, ho, ho!
What do you find so funny?
Funny? No, no, nothing, nothing funny, no. I was merely attempting to be jovial.
Well, you better make the most of it, mate.
I'm sorry. I don't understand what you mean. I mean, don't you have a little child with you at all?
You are joking.
Well, no, I mean, I know it doesn't say children only, but it is most unusual.
This is between you and me, Santa.
Oh, yes, well, if you insist. But I think we'll do without the sitting on the knee, if that's all the same with you.
I'm glad you think it's funny, pal. Because I don't, I promise you. Neither did my missus when she brought my lad in here yesterday, and you went on at her about how demanding you were, how greedy. You really upset her, you did.
No.
And I don't like that.
Yes, yes, I think I'm with you now. No, actually, it wasn't me, it was somebody else. Got the wrong man.
Oh, is that right? Well, that's funny, because my missus gave me a fairly good description. Red suit, white whiskers.
No, no, you don't understand. You've got the wrong person. Really have. You're making a mistake here.
Not as big a mistake as you made when you insulted my missus yesterday. Now, I'm here to tell you, happen she'll bring our Carlton in again to make up for yesterday. And I'm warning you, any more lip from you and you won't live to see Christmas. Have you got that?
Yes.
I said, got that?
Yes.
Right. You be sure you don't forget it.
As if a difficult time at work wasn't enough, Reg and Curly found themselves left to their own devices over the festive season. They also had little in the way of supplies and Christmas goodies, but Reg was not a man to be easily thwarted.
What's it to be now, then? Is it family and friends?
No, not really. I'm going home, on my own.
Oh, no, you can't be serious.
Yeah.
No, we can't be having that. You can't be on your own on Christmas Day. It's immoral, is that? I wouldn't be surprised if we can't get done for it.
Why, where are you going?
Me? Well, actually, I've left mine
a bit late. Oh, come on, Reg, be honest. You're not going anywhere. We're stuck on our own.
Well, all right, not anymore. I mean, here we are. Let's make the best of it. After all, we are a sort of a family, aren't we? The better by extended family.
Yeah.
Well, then. Can't be beyond us to knock up a passable sort of Christmas dinner between us, even at this late date.
I've got a chicken, one of those we were selling cheap.
Well, there you are. Things are on the up. Chicken already in the oven. We have a feast in the making.
It's only a chicken.
Only a chicken? There speaks the voice of affluence, Norman. Here, when I was a lad, if you had a chicken for Christmas dinner, they used to cook you at door home so neighbours could smell it and see how well you were doing. Eh, you did? Here. Tell you what. We'll do this thing properly. We will raid the pantry.
What pantry?
Well, what pantry do you think? Which shelves groaning with food and drink, to which only you and I have access?
What, better buys?
Absolutely. It might be only chicken, but it will be only chicken with the caviar and champagne, which I will now go and bring, while you look after the domestic side of things. Right, keys. Have you got the keys to the storeroom with you?
Yeah, yeah. Hey, listen, we're going to have to pay for all this stuff.
Hey, I've trained you well, haven't I? I have trained you well. Of course we'll pay for it, but not now, later when we open. You see, one thing you have to learn, Norman, is that we who hold the keys to the kingdom, we're not like other men. No, we are privileged. And on certain occasions, like today, well, we may take advantage of those privileges.
Can I have your glasses, please?
Of course you can, yeah. Betty. And with those glasses, our admiration and affection for the wonderful job you have done. Au revoir, Betty, love.
Yeah.
Norman?
Madman or genius, Betty, I just don't know. And I work with him every day.
Rather you than me, though, love.
Last minute shopping, aren't we?
Yes, yes, well, a matter of speaking, yes. I was just collecting a few extra things, actually.
I'm surprised they're open.
Oh, no, they're not open, no.
Oh, really?
That was a joke, yes, of course. actually, I am the manager. My name's Holdsworth. I've got the keys. I mean, I really wouldn't be the manager, would I, if I didn't have the keys? There they are.
Holdsworth?
Yes.
Then why have these keys got the name Watts attached to them?
Ah, well, that is because they're not actually my keys. They belong to Mr. Watts.
Mr. Watts?
Yes, assistant manager.
Is he?
Yes, and he gave me his keys because I didn't have mine. That's why, I suppose.
I see.
Yes. In that case, I will be off. Thank you very much. And may I say, on behalf of Better Buys, thank you for your vigilance.
Get in.
Oh,
I think we'd better sort this at the station.
No. I am who I say I am. It's just I don't have any positive identification at the moment.
In! And bring the evidence with you.
Right. Thank you. I can explain everything.
The lost love of Reg's life, Maureen Naylor, started work at Better Buys, and Reg found that he still cared for her. The road to happiness is never smooth, and this one was to be no exception.
I'll be with you in a jiffy.
I see. Well, when you've got a minute, head office want you to ring personnel.
All right, we'll call. I'll get back to the engine room. Might take a well-earned tea break. Mm. Sorry about that, Maureen. Am I right? You have a sweet tooth?
Yes.
Hey, do you remember Blackpool? Oh. Candy floss. I win. Tragedy. I've never laughed so much in all my life. Oh, what are you doing tonight?
What?
Tonight. Do you want to go out for a meal? Chinese, Indian, anything you want. Do you know, it's taken 20 years off me, has this, you turning up. What time do you think?
Well, look, I really can't make it tonight.
Oh, well, some other night, then.
Well...
Tomorrow.
Right. I'm off. I've got a hot date with a cold lasagna.
Oh, no, Norman. Stay a bit longer. Women might be fickle, but we men don't desert each other when the chips are down, do we?
Hello.
Maureen, what are you doing here?
Well, Ivy Brennan told me it was your local, and I felt so rotten about letting you down that I've managed to change my plans. Is it all right if I join you?
All right. Oh, I'm absolutely delighted. Norman, get Mrs. Naylor what she's drinking, and I'll have the same. And then, didn't you say something about having an urgent appointment? Well, go on, go in. Good night.
Thank you. Are you sure about this, Reg?
Oh, yes. She won't recognise me after 20 years.
She never did like you. When you realise as who you are, that'll be it.
No. When you take me in, just call me Norman. Guarantee in 10 minutes I'll have her eating out of my hand. Then when I judge the moment is right, hey presto, I'll reveal our little deception. And hopefully we'll all have a good laugh about it.
That's Mum at the window.
Aye, I thought it might be. It's all come flooding back now, still. In for a penny, in for a pound, eh?
Mother, I'd like you to meet...
What? Norman what?
What's he want?
Well, he's going to have some tea with his mother.
Well, I didn't ask him.
No, I asked him, Mother.
You never said anything.
May I say what a great pleasure this is, Mrs. Grimes?
How do you know my name?
I
don't know you, do I?
Well, I told him your name, of course, Mother.
Do I know you?
Well, I sincerely hope you will know me, Mrs. Grimes.
Maureen. Find me glasses. I put me glasses down somewhere. I just can't think.
Make yourself at home. Take a seat.
Oh. Don't sit on my glasses. I sometimes put them on the sofa. Maureen, find me glasses.
Oh. Well, they're not on the sofa, Mrs. Grimes. I'll take great care not to sit on your glasses, Mrs. Grimes, because I wouldn't want to make a spectacle of myself. Make a spectacle of
myself. So what did you do with them? Where did you have them last?
If I knew that, they wouldn't be lost, would they? I think I've met you somewhere.
Oh, that's perfectly possible. Do you shop at Better Buy supermarket at all?
No, I don't. Hey, that's where our Maureen works.
Well, of course it is, Mother. He's my boss.
Yes, I do have that honour. Your daughter and my good self are very good friends.
You see, that's why we brought him home, so he can meet you.
So, what have you got for me tea?
30 years. It's come out of the Stone Age as grocery. Oh, yes. And we executives, we've had to evolve at the same speed. In fact, it's like putting evolution to fast forward. Are you with me?
Hi, Adam. I just took them off for a minute.
So, what do you get amongst your managerial staff? Ruthless natural selection. Weakest go to the wall, survival of the fittest. Amongst whom, in modesty, I include myself.
Hey, Adam, in me hand, I just can't think.
See, people have to change. And they do change. One acquires wisdom, polish, few of the world's trinkets, house, car, waterbed, etc.
Tea won't be 5 minutes.
We've been having a fascinating discussion, your mother and me. I was just saying...
Well, here's me glasses, under the evening paper. It's him. It's what's his name? It's Reg Holdsworth, that's who it is. I thought I smelt a rat.
Now, Mother.
If I could just say something, Mrs.
What's he changed his name for? Are the police after him?
He hasn't changed his name. We just want you to be reasonable and give him a chance.
May I just say...
Give him a chance? I wouldn't give him the steam off me tea.
I'd just like to say, Mrs. Grimes, if I can get a word in edgeways, that Maureen and I, having found each other again after all these years, we were just anxious to reassure you...
You always did make a meal out of a mouthful, even when you were a kid. Telling me about how everything's changed. Some things never change. A pillock's always a pillock. And a muck heap's always a muck heap.
Oh, hello. Maureen, it's Reg. About last night.
Reg, I meant what I said. I feel dreadful about what happened. But I can't put you through it again.
Does our friendship mean so little? You're willing to give up on it so easily.
Easily? Oh, Reg, I've never slept all night worrying about it. But I know what will happen. Oh, my mother will turn you against me. And I just couldn't bear it.
I'll never turn against you, Maureen, never.
I know, you say that now. But I know what she's like. And I know what you're like. You're a man with a lot of pride. And I'd just rather we parted now. Why, you remember me with some affection. Oh, bye, Reg. Take care of yourself.
Do you really think I'm the sort of puny person that gives up at the first hurdle?
Oh, it won't work. You've seen what my mother's like. She'll make our lives a misery.
Maureen, I'm not the callow youth of yesteryear. I'm a man of steel, honed on the handle of life.
But it's an awful risk.
Well, it's a risk I'm prepared to take. I'm quite sure that given time, I can win Maud over. Just...
Maureen! Who's that at the door?
I won't be a minute, Mother. Do you want to come in and say hello?
No. I'll leave it for tonight, thanks. No, I'll give her a few days, you know, to get used to me being back on the scene. And then I'll start my campaign to woo her in earnest. They do say I'm quite potent when I put my mind to it. So don't worry, darling. Your mother will be putty in my hands.
Reg, you're so masterful.
Maureen, I want to know who you're talking to, girl.
You, my love. Until tomorrow, then. Mm-hmm.
Until tomorrow.
Maureen!
Oh, I mean, they've got cars for everything these days, haven't they? Have you got a car for nothing in particular?
Yes, on the top at the end, the nothing in particulars.
All right. Unless, of course, there's an oil and troubled waters category.
Oh, not been falling out with,
No. We are, mir simpatico. No, it's the mother and me. It's more dog and cat, you
Ah, Mavis, now, you'll be all right, will you?
Yes, I'm just going to shut that door at dinner time and that's it.
Well, we could perhaps have a hot pot at the Rovers, oh, eh?
Derek, I was about to say the same thing. Oh, we are we simpatico, aren't we?
What?
Oh, never mind them. Mm. Do you think that DIY shop will be open?
Well, I don't mind the walk anyway. Bit of fresh air. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Anyway, I thought I'll make me peace. Oh. Nice little card and a box of chocolates.
Oh, now that one up there with the gold tassels. I was hoping somebody would buy me that.
Yes, well, I've got me on to shift. You've heard of the European chocolate mountain, because most of it's still down at Betterby. Ta-da! Hello, Mrs. Grimes. I trust I find you well.
Well, as can be expected, Reginald.
I held this one back in the stockroom, Mrs. Grimes. I hope you like chocolate.
Oh, chocolate, is it?
Yes, it's an Easter egg, Mrs. Grimes. Quite a familiar product these days, these.
I may be in this, but it doesn't take 50 years off my mental age. I was saying, I don't accept chocolates or pleasure of a Good Friday.
Oh, right, right, yeah.
I may not be able to get to chapel, because some people don't open it.
Mother.
But I can be a Christian in me old mind. No. Would you open that door, Maureen? Mm-hmm. I don't think I'm a child. There you are, my love.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now, Reg, I won't take no for an answer. After all, you taught me that all them years back.
Miguel, please, can't you see? I mean, come here.
20 pence a go or 6 for a pound. It's a once-only offer, to take it or leave it.
It's a highly embarrassing decision. I do apologise, Maureen.
Thank you, love.
Thank you.
We'll take 6. Yeah. I've got a pound here, look. What's it for? Well, it's not much of a prize, if you ask me, but it's a good cause. It's Weatherfield old folks' home.
Oh, right, we'll take a dozen.
Oh.
Small price to pay to provide a haven for those in their twilight years.
Oh, don't bother spending your money. I'm in the lucky street. There's nobody else that's a chance for me.
Attention, everybody. Raffle tickets to the ready. We're about to do the draw.
Come on, come on.
Have you seen Neil in here?
No, I haven't. Hey, quick, grab this last ticket. We're about to draw the raffle. Your boyfriend would do mean to buy any lunchtime. You owe me 20p.
Raquel, will you bring Stubbs over here, please? And I'd like to ask my husband to do the draw.
Oh, yeah.
Right, it's a green ticket and it's number 74. Yeah.
Green 74. Anybody? No?
Hey, hold up. Stop.
Yeah, it's one of yours.
Oh, I want
my
money back.
It's not what you know, it's who you know.
Look, I don't want any of your prizes, love, all right? Give it to Phyllis, okay? I'll see you in the morning.
Oh, lovely tarpet.
Right, hang on to your tickets, everybody. We'll have a redraw. Oh. Raquel.
All right. Right, yellow. 495, yellow 495.
Well,
well, well.
Excuse me,
hey, what an unexpected treat. I knew this was going to be our special night, Maureen. It's doing even better now.
Is there something wrong with it, Reg?
Where did that come from?
Curly. Why? Any objections?
No, no. It's lovely. It really, really is. It's just similar to something Reg bought my mother.
Wait till I see that Norman Watts. I'll give him charity.
Even when Maureen's mother wasn't around, she cast a long shadow, and she was to cause trouble for Reg and Maureen for a long time. Reg was worried that she would drive them apart, as she'd done 20 years before.
Da-da-da. Chocolat.
Oh, thank you.
I thought we might make ourselves more comfortable at this juncture, if you're agreeable. Let the meal digest itself.
I didn't know you could cook, Reg.
Well, good food. There's nothing without good company. Mm. And you, Maureen, are of the choice of right in that department.
Oh.
I think you know the nature of my feelings towards you, don't you? Recent obstacles might have dampened a lesser passion, but it's only served to increase mine. But I don't know if these feelings are reciprocated.
You know they are, Reg.
Well, in that case, if I may be so bold, could I bestow a token of my affection?
It doesn't look as though I can stop you, does it?
No, I don't think you can.
Aren't you going to answer it, Reg? Because it could be my mother, you know.
All the more reason to ignore it, I would have thought.
How could you say such a thing?
Look, just put yourself first for once, will you, Maureen? You've been a martyr to that woman.
Look, answer it, Reg, please. Oh. Because I won't be able to, well, relax properly until I know it's not her.
Hello? What do you mean, if she's here? You know damn well she's here. Why do you keep...
Hello, Mother? Yes, are you all right? What? No! Oh. How long have you been there? Oh, that's terrible. Yes! No, 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 I'll be back straight away. Yes, don't move, will you? Right, bye.
Hey, so that's it, is it?
What?
You're going to carry on just going back to her, running away at her every behest?
Don't you want to know what's wrong with her?
Not specially, no.
Oh, well, for your information, my mother has fallen out of her wheelchair. And she is lying on the coal kitchen floor.
Oh, well, in that case, how come she got to the phone?
I I don't know. She probably crawled.
Oh, Maureen, can't you see this is just a ruse to get you away from
no,
here?
No, 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 I do not see that. And if your desire to have your way with me on that sofa is stronger than your concern for my mother...
Yes?
Yes, well, then I am not sure that there is a future for us, Reg Holdsworth.
Maureen,
I know this much, Maureen. We have to snatch our happiness. We must chase that bright, elusive butterfly of love with nets of wonder.
Just somehow we don't seem fated.
Forget fate, Maureen. Not some blind, malevolent force we're up against. It's your mother. Come to think about it, it does describe her, doesn't it?
Well, what can we do?
Look, if we meet again tonight, she'll find some way to ruin it. She'll either get stuck in the bath, or a wheelchair will break down on the hard shoulder of the M62. Whatever it is, she'll find some way to stop us consummating our love.
You're right, it's hopeless.
No, it's not. Because instead of having our amorous rendezvous tonight, we shall be having it this afternoon. You and I, Maureen, are taking the rest of the day off.
We can't do that.
I'm the manager of the store, and what I say goes. We shall do it, and we will do it. Follow me. Oh, Mrs. Brennan?
Yes, Mr. Holdsworth.
Mrs. Naylor here has a sick headache.
Oh, I am sorry. Shall I see that she gets to rest room?
No. I shall be sending Mrs. Naylor home. Would you take over her duties for the rest of the shift, Mrs. Brennan?
Yes, certainly. Hope you feel better soon, love.
Yes,
Right. Meet me in the car park in 5 minutes by my car.
But, Reg...
Off you go. I'll be joining you shortly. No, come here. You've really got to see
it. Why can't you show me in the living room?
Because it's in here and what? It's staring you in the face.
What, the bed?
Mm.
Well, I've seen a bed before.
Yeah, but not like this. Try sitting on it.
What? What is it?
It's a water bed.
What? A water bed?
Mm.
I've never been in a water bed before.
No woman has ever been in this bed, Maureen. I bought it when I became single again. Nobody's ever shared it. Oh. It was if... Deep down, Maureen, I was saving it. Saving myself, if you wish. Knowing that deep down, somehow, some subconscious level, fate would bring you back to me again.
Oh,
Eric! Do you want to mark up the evening papers for me?
No, I do not. I'll just sort out this light for you.
Well, we can manage now till tomorrow, and then I'll ask an electrician to come in.
Stop harping on about an electrician, Mavis. I'm perfectly capable of...
Oh, Mavis.
Oh.
There's water coming through.
Close your eyes.
Must I?
I'm not coming in unless you close your eyes.
All right, I've closed them.
Oh, it's cold in here.
Can I open my eyes now?
Yes.
I don't know what you made me close them for.
Well, because I'm not as beautiful as I used to be.
Oh, yes, you are. To me, Maureen.
Oh. You're not going to keep your glasses on, are you?
Hmm?
Glasses.
Oh, no. Not if it bothered you, no.
Oh.
Just...
Whoops! Oh, it's a bit squashy, the bed, isn't it?
Yes, it sort of moulds itself to your contours.
Yes. A bit more give in it than I expected.
Do you know, I can't believe this is happening. I keep thinking I'm going to wake up and all this will just be a dream.
It's not a dream, Reg.
Hmm.
Do you know something?
No.
My horoscope this morning, do you know what it said?
No.
You're going to have a big surprise across the water.
Oh. Good Lord, that is uncanny, that. Hey, Maureen.
Yes?
I can't tell you what this means to me. Having the love of my life beside me here at last.
Oh.
Oh, Maureen.
Oh,
can you open the door? We need someone.
Who's that? Mr. Holdsworth! Shh! Just ignore it, Maureen. It doesn't matter.
Mr. Holdsworth!
Are you up there?
Who is it? What do they want?
I don't know and I don't care. Look, if we just keep nice and quiet, they'll go away. Look. You see? Maureen.
We're coming up!
Break it down,
Derek! What the hell are you playing at?
Oh, Mr. Holdsworth, thank goodness you're all right.
We thought you were dead in your bath.
Hey!
Well, there's water cascading from here down into the cabin.
It's coming right down the walls.
You come back in at my door.
Matt!
Here, what's happening?
The bed's collapsing! There's water all over the place!
Well, you better get
We're bursting. I'll say there's bursting. This is where the water's from, maybe. This idiot's water bed.
Derek, you must have drilled into it when you drilled.
Drilling? What's all this about drilling? You drilled into me water bed, you imbecile. My wife said it was without prejudice, but sheer speculation. No man in his right mind would keep a water bed in his bedroom.
Look what you've done, you fool. I'll have you finished.
You burst this bed. You and your friend here with your activity.
Oh, Jane! Come here.
Where are you both? Shut up. Oh, my God! Get out of this contraption and get my clothes on!
Reg finally felt that things had gone on long enough and decided to tackle Maud head on and clear the air.
Hello? Who is it? Oh, I think it was some burglar.
No, it's just me. Called to have a word.
Mind, happen I'd have preferred a burglar. You know where you are with them.
Now, Maud.
And what's this I hear from our Maureen about you pestering her again? What will it take before you learn to leave us both well alone? And how did you get in just now, anyway?
Maureen lent me her key.
Silly girl.
Yes, I gather she told you we're back together again.
She said something. I weren't really listening.
Oh, weren't you? Right, well, just so you shouldn't be in any doubt, let me tell you loud and clear. Your daughter and I are engaged to be married.
Huh.
Oh, sorry, what was that? Congratulations.
Don't you get funny with me.
And there's something else I should tell you as well. I know you don't want us to get married, and I also know why you don't want us to get married.
Because you're not suited.
Oh, yes, we are. We're remarkably suited.
She's worth seven of you.
Quite possibly, but that's not the point. No, the reason why you don't want us to get married is because you are frightened of being left alone. You've got used to her looking after you, and you want her to go on looking after you.
Looking after me? Mm. And who do you think looks after her?
I don't think anybody does, which is a situation I intend to remedy.
Oh, go on, get out. You come here bandying words.
No, wait. You haven't heard what I've got to say yet. Maureen can still look after you, even after we're married. In fact, we both will.
Is this money? Is all this because you think I've got money to leave her?
No, it is not money. No, it's that other common motive which may not have occurred to you. Love. Love is what it is, Mrs. Grimes. And I suggest you recognise that, if only for your own benefit. Because if you continue to try and turn your daughter against me, I shall take her away from here. Oh, yes. You mark my words, I shall take her away from here and away from you, and then you won't have anybody to look after you. And I shan't have the slightest qualm, because it will be nobody's fault but your own. Do you understand? Good. Well, back to work then, eh, Maud? You'll have to say it again, won't you?
I've said over and over. You know what she's like when she gets something in her head?
Well, why does she get it into her head in the first place?
Because she's got nothing to do all day but brood, that's why.
Brood?
Yes.
What is it to brood on?
Oh.
You've just asked your mother to your own engagement party. What is it to brood over?
Because she knows we don't really want her, that's why.
Look. She doesn't want to come because she doesn't like me.
Oh, don't be
so silly. She makes out it is us who don't like her, so she can feel aggrieved and we get the blame. Oh. This is what I object to, you know.
I said, come on, Mum. Be reasonable.
If she won't come, she won't come, that's it.
She will come if you ask her.
I've asked.
I mean, really ask her, you know, in your own words.
Well, she wants me to call you.
Look, I've said to her, get on to Dialer Ride, get them to bring you in, you know, this afternoon, as if by chance.
All right, look, I will crawl, but I'll crawl a yard. I'm not crawling a mile. And if she still doesn't want to come, that's it. Because the party's going ahead now. Everything's going ahead. God.
Hello.
There.
No,
it's
not
for me.
Come on, get down. Splendid. Mrs. Grimes. How splendid to see you in my emporium again. Where would you like to go to first?
Well, what have you got that I'd like?
Well, I'll tell you what I'd like first, Mrs. Grimes. I'd like you to come and raise a glass with us tonight.
You don't want me there.
Oh, yes, I do, Mrs. Grimes.
Go and enjoy yourself. You don't want some useless old woman.
Oh, yes, I certainly do. As a matter of fact, I have set your invitation to verse, Mrs. Grimes.
Come on.
Right, now, here we go. Listen. Dear Mrs. Grimes, we're having a do.
because I want to marry your daughter. Oh. But what good would it do without you? Please come, because you know you ought to.
It's a lunatic.
Lovely.
Dear Mrs. Grimes, we're having a drink. There'll be punch bowls and flagons of porter. But if you don't come, do you know what I think? You'll be turning wine into water. Now, are you coming?
Come, if you stop embarrassing me.
Right, it's settled then. Power of poetry, that.
Wonderful, Reggie.
Here we go.
Oh, I see. It's big as the devil.
Mrs. Gilroy, do you mind if I get the doors open just to get the chair through?
Oh, you've talked her into it, then?
Yes, I have, yes. But you might find she's a bit awkward to get on with it first, just to put it mildly, so you can make some adjustments.
Oh, yes, lovely.
Oh, these are nice, aren't they? Did you make these yourself?
Oh, can I give a hand at all?
It's all right. She knows how to do it.
There's no trouble. Where are you off to?
Just in there.
Yes.
You live in... Yes.
Yeah, over there. Yes. Right.
You're the man with the drill.
Yes, I'm at least said so to spend it.
This is my mother.
Oh, well, delighted.
Yes.
Friend of Reginald's, are you?
Let's say we're acquainted. Put it like that. This is Mavis.
You'll be coming in to have a drink with us then, anyway.
Right, time to pipe you aboard, Mother. Good evening, Derek.
You must drink there out. It's all on Reginald, you know.
Yes, yes, you must, you must.
Right, you we'll pop in later, perhaps.
Please do, please do. Here we are.
Thank you.
Perfect.
Now, with the engagement arranged and a date set for the wedding, Maureen was feeling more confident. She decided that after the Better Buys party, would be the time to throw caution to the wind and make their dreams come true.
You booked it for the night, did you?
Well, fate has thwarted us one way or another so many times, Reg, that... Well, I decided that this time I wouldn't take any chances.
Oh, a clever, clever, darling comment.
There's nothing to stand in our way now, Reg, nothing.
Do you know, this is why you're the woman for me. I'm a simple, wild, wonderful jest.
Oh, I love you, Reg.
Yes, and I love you, Maureen.
Oh, no, wait. No, listen. There's a robe in the bathroom. Why don't you go and make yourself comfortable? And then when you have, well, you... Right.
You look lovely, Maureen.
Come to bed, Reggie.
Maureen.
Oh, Reggie.
No, not just...
Reggie,
it's
no.
Just one, no.
No,
wait, listen. There's one thing I have to say to Maureen, Reggie? Before we... Listen.
What?
Before we finally consummate our relation.
Yeah.
I'm anxious, darling, that there should be nothing between us. Nothing at all.
No.
No, no secrets.
No.
No hidden past, no lies, and no skeletons in their cupboard, so...
Yes.
There's, I have to say something.
Right.
Something which you might find difficult to believe.
Oh, Reggie.
No, listen.
What?
To me.
What?
You see, the pain and frustration.
Yes.
Brought on by the twists of fate that kept me from you, forced me to lapse and thrust me into the arms of another.
Yes.
Now, I know I have no excuse for my unfaithfulness, Maureen. And. Well, I freely confess to you, and I understand if you ban me from this bedchamber, but in my frustration, I've had carnal knowledge of Brenda Fallon. Well, a young lady at third office.
Oh, wretch.
I'm sorry.
Oh,
do you forgive me?
Oh, yes, my darling, I forgive you.
Oh, thank you.
You see, I've not been entirely blameless myself. You see, I've not behaved as I should have. I've been a naughty little girl as well.
Oh, have you?
Yes.
Oh, well, I don't believe that. Who is it, darling? You can tell me if it makes you feel better.
Well, it's Norman, Reggie.
Norman?
Yes.
Norman who?
Curly.
You slept with Curly One?
Reg?
Curly One?
Reg?
I don't believe it.
No, Reg.
No.
I thought I'd lost you, Reg. I thought I was going to have to face life without you. I was desperate for consolation, and Mr. Watts just happened to be there and offer it, that's all.
Mr. Watts was consolation, was it?
No, Mr. Watts wasn't anything. He couldn't measure up to you, Reg.
Really?
He's not half the man you are. All it did was make me realise the terrible wrong that I'd done. That there could never, ever be any man to take your place. Please, please try and understand.
All I understand, Maureen, is that when you were confronted with temptation, you succumbed. And who with? With Norman Watts? Oh.
I'm not as strong as you are, Reg. You've got to be strong enough for both of us. I'm nothing without you. Look at me. I mean, what have I done with my life? What did I have in my life before you came back on the scene? No future. Where would I be without you?
Yes, but that doesn't alter the fact, Maureen. You have humiliated me. I mean, every time I see Norman Watts,
I know. You feel anger and you feel hatred because of what he did to me. A woman vulnerable, I know.
Well, that's a woman's interpretation. But it's different for a man, you see. It's different for a man because it's a matter of honour.
Isn't it?
Hmm?
Right, well, and don't worry, I won't tell anybody the real reason.
The real reason? What do you mean, the real reason?
Well, for cancelling the wedding.
Well, who said I said anything about cancelling the wedding?
Is the wedding still on, then?
Well, I'm not a man who can forgive easily, Maureen. Not a man who can forget those responsible, either. But if you think for one minute that I'm going to give Norman what's the satisfaction of thinking that he's responsible for blighting our future.
Oh, Reg.
Can't be. Come on, Evan.
Morning.
Morning.
Everything all right?
No.
Why, what's wrong?
Here, a list of possible redundancies.
Dead office?
Yes.
Well, it had to be done. Let's have a look. Sonia Barsley. Well, I'd have to agree with that one. John Crabshaw Anderson. Certainly. Peter Scaife. All right. Maureen Naylor. Is this how you get your own back?
What?
Oh, go on. Pretend you didn't know nothing about it. What's this? Maureen Naylor, Elijah's life. There.
It's got nothing to do with me.
Don't you give me that.
I have been denying that there won't be any more redundancies. I have told my staff categorically that their jobs are safe.
You want to get it into your head, you know. Maureen's one of the best workers you've got.
Oh, yeah, she's okay. She comes in late, she goes home early, and she spends the whole day gassing.
Right, we know where we stand now, don't we?
Look, I don't like it, but what can I do?
Oh, well, you can wash your hands of it, hey? Well, my Maureen goes to the wall. Right. I'm going right to the dead office, me. Hey, this is not a threat, just a warning. I have done you your last favour in this organisation, pal. You savvy, sunshine. All right, I'll see you. Come here. I have spoken to the man Watts, and he will not budge. As I thought, it is personal animosity, and he is going through you to get at me.
I didn't think he'd be like that.
Yes, well, the man is totally unscrupulous, isn't he?
Oh,
well, you know that, don't you? You know that better than anybody. Only this time he won't get his way. I'm going right over his head.
What do you mean?
I am taking the matter to the highest managerial authority. Mrs. Rogers is due this evening, and by the time I have tattled her, Mr. Watts will wish that he had not meddled with either of us.
Oh, no, Reggie. No, but... Oh, dear me.
Mate, it's Betty. I'm ready for this. Do you want one?
No, you're all right, love.
All right, love.
Reggie, what's wrong?
Wrong. Everything's wrong.
I don't understand it. You see, Mrs. Rogers.
Oh, yes, that's all right. You've schemed and plotted for this, haven't you? I took you out of the gutter into that store.
I don't know what you're on about.
You took advantage of my kindness like you took advantage of my fiancée.
Reg, tush!
You and your redundancy schemes.
Excuse me.
Hey?
Reg, just calm down. No. Shut up. Sit down. Now tell me what it's all about.
Right. Well, I went to see Mrs. Rogers, yes. And I told her if they didn't want you, they'd have to do without me as well. And she said, well, if that was my decision, that was fine by her. Hey? After all the years I'd put in there, the tears, the sweat, the blood, for all that... I'm out, Maureen, I'm out.
Oh, Reg.
Not a good prospect for Reg and Maureen teetering on the brink of marriage, but Reg is nothing if not resourceful, and with Maureen's encouragement, they called on Alf Roberts.
Oh, that carton, get it shifted, will you?
Shall I put a clean penny on as well?
Well, that's not dirty, is it?
No, Alf, I was joking.
Oh.
Harry is Patel, you know. He's got three properties already. He's got two in Rosamond Street.
Well, don't let him beat you down, because he will if he can.
Yeah, well, he's after that property in Nelson Street as well, you know.
That's very nice. I wouldn't trust him if there's not a throwaway.
Oh, you haven't just dumped it in the storeroom, have you?
No, Alf, I've had it.
Oh, thank you.
Calm down, Alf. He's running us ragged.
Felicitations, ladies. Alfredo, if you haven't already met my intended, this is Maureen.
Look, it's the wrong time, is this? I'm sorry, Reg. Sorry, love. Yeah, I've got people coming, though, to see the shop.
Yes, yes, I know. C'est moi. What?
Hey?
It's me. Us. Yeah. Alfredo! Well, this is a good opportunity to return the books and convey to you my admiration for the punctilious way you keep your accounts.
You're satisfied now. You've had a good nosy.
Are you interested or what, Reg?
Well, it just depends on how far the good counselor can move on his asking price.
You know the figures. 73,000.
Suppose I said 65.
Suppose I said push off.
At least we can't talk about it, Alfie.
We have talked about it. You've had your fun. Good night.
Alf, Audrey.
Good evening.
Pleasant occasion.
Yes, I'd just like to say 68,000 stock at valuation. And the next round's on me. What do you think?
Stock at valuation? 68,000. Aye, go on then, and mine's a double.
Oh, right.
Maureen, yeah. Go over here.
Reg, God bless you.
Hey.
Mother, we've got some news for you.
I thought there was something. You both being back here in the afternoon.
Well, you know I'm finishing with Better Buys.
Despite your fiancé cracking on, he runs the place.
That's just it, you see, because Reggie is leaving as well.
Yes.
Leaving as well? Is this right?
Hey, hang on, there's more to come.
So, what we're doing, we have bought Alf Roberts' corner shop, and we're going to run it between us.
Coronation Street?
Yes.
Well, I think you're making a grave mistake, and you'll live to regret it.
See? What did I tell you?
We wanted you to be pleased for us.
What is there to be pleased about? Oh. Porky little shop like that.
Porky little gold mine?
Yeah. Together there every day, together at home, and then together at work.
Well, and why not?
I'll give you a month, and you'll be sick of the sight of one another.
Do you know, it is so nice to have your full backing encouragement. It really is.
Yeah. I speak the truth. I always have, and I always will.
Oh. And that makes you feel good, does it? Never mind how it upsets other people.
Mother, we want to share these things with you. We don't want to be having to talk about them behind your back, do we?
Well, I can't see the sense of it. Leaving a big firm for a little shop like that.
Yes, yes, it is a gamble. Yes, I admit it. And it is going to take a lot of hard work and commitment to pull it off, which is why I, moi, needs all the help and encouragement I can get here.
Which you will have from me.
Thank you.
I'm not saying I don't want you to do well. I do. I hope it works out for the both of you.
Nice of you to say so.
Why couldn't you have said that in the beginning?
I don't know. It's just the way I am.
With the future secured, all that remained was for them to find somewhere to live. Maud was, of course, going to be the usual problem. Rita's house was on the market, and it seemed ideal, but Maureen was none too pleased to find out that Reg had known Rita before.
You nursed your husband to the end, you say?
Well, yes. We were together right until the last moment.
Did you hear that, you two?
Yes, but Rita knew that the last moment was just around the corner. No, what I mean to say was the end came about rather quickly, didn't it, Rita?
Too quickly, Reg, yes. Anyway, you're here to have a good look round and judge the house for yourself. So I'll just open the gate and I'll see you inside.
I'm sure Reg can find his way.
Apparently she's been married twice.
Yeah.
Quite a catch. Dedicated woman with her own business. Must be her strength and independence they find so attractive, I suppose. Bit surprised she's a friend of yours, Reg. Still. Lovely woman like that does tend to see good in everyone, I suppose.
Well, let's get on with it, then. Just remember, we're here to see what she has to offer.
Those of us who don't already know, shall we?
Maureen, where are you going?
I'm looking at the garden that she keeps raving on about.
You don't live in the garden, you live in the house, don't you?
What's this husband of hers like?
Lou, Peters, well, it's not my cup of tea. Why? What do you...
Mother seems to have taken to her.
Who?
Rita! You two have found something in common at last, haven't you?
What is your problem, Maureen? Oh. This is all becoming very embarrassing these days.
You should have told me, Reg.
What?
You know!
Oh, yes, I see. Well, yes, I mean, there was a time when she pursued me. Yes, but I never encouraged it. I mean, you've seen her about Coronation Street yourself, Maureen. Have you ever noticed a flicker of interest on my part, eh?
No.
No! That's because I only have eyes for you. You're the woman for me, Maureen. Come here.
Reggie.
Eh? Yes. I don't...
Everything all right? Oh, sorry. I see you found the garden.
Yes. It's lovely, isn't it?
Yes.
Yes, but I'm not sure it's the house
for
me.
No, it's
because,
fine. Eh? It's a beautiful home, Rita.
What's this?
Shall I?
Just see. Reggie.
What?
Shall we go and look at the bedroom?
Absolutely. Come here. Hey. Rita?
Reg? Not suitable, eh?
Well, I mean, it was far from perfection, actually.
Well, that's all right. Very good of you to let me know. I mean, it's been standing idle nearly a year.
Yes. Well, 101 repairs scream out at the naked eye. I'm sure a survey would reveal 100 more.
Well, no point in going to the expense of a survey if you're not interested.
Oh, well, we're not interested. You see, Maureen has a less critical eye than me, but she did say that, well, she thought the place had atmosphere, actually.
Good. Mm-hmm. So what are we actually talking here?
Well, it all depends, really, on how much we'd have to spend if we were to purchase your property. But we wouldn't want to start conversing unless it was, well, 10,000 less than the asking price.
10,000?
Well, we have Maureen's mother to think about. And the place needs major adjustments just to get a wheelchair in, doesn't it?
Well, yes, I can appreciate it, Reg. But that's not something I have to take into account when I'm selling it.
No, well, you wouldn't have to, would you? I mean, your Teddy didn't even need the equipment that Maud does. Let's face it, it didn't even look like an invalid, did it?
I beg your pardon.
No, well, I mean, well, it was a lovely house he left behind, but it wouldn't be one that we'd be interested in above the figure I've mentioned, really.
Right. And I'll think about it and let you know.
Take all the time you want.
Tell me, how did she react to lowering the price, 2,000? Or what, was it 3,000?
Well, occasionally I come up against a better business mind than the old man, obviously.
Oh,
well, I'm sorry, I just...
Oh, it's all my fault. I know I behaved badly, but I really did love the place.
Maybe.
I thought we'd found our dream home at last. Mother wasn't totally against it, which is a major plus. Oh, I really wanted to go for it.
Yeah.
Do you know, I didn't think 72,000 was too much of an insult.
Rita obviously did.
Yeah.
She's a very nervy woman, that Maureen Naylor. Still, I suppose it's the prospects of spending the rest of your life with Reg.
No, Rita, you've lost your chance. Bitterness doesn't become you.
Bitter? Jack, I've never been more grateful to another woman in all my life. Reg?
Oh.
Maureen?
Yeah.
Look, I know I said I'd think it over, but really, what's there to think over?
Well, that's real estate, Rita.
Yeah, well, I've heard enough about that to last me a lifetime this last 12 months. Reg, you drive a hard bargain, but I have to be realistic. Do all the surveys you want, but I'm willing to go to 65,000.
65,000? That's wonderful. Isn't that wonderful?
Oh, yes, that's wonderful. Do you mind if we just talk over it, if it's
no,
all right?
No, you go right ahead.
What is it to talk over? What did you say to her this afternoon?
Oh, this and that.
Oh, you're a genius. We'll be able to be together at long last. Oh.
All three of us, yeah.
We must rush home and tell Mother. No. You must tell her. She has to be impressed. Oh, Reg, you must feel so proud of yourself.
Too clever for my own good sometime.
I'll just not put it in the till.
Can I get you a refill, Winter?
No, thanks, Reg. I've got to get back to the shop in a minute. Let Mavis out for a dinner.
Oh, right. I'm in a certain amount of haste myself this afternoon. Young Norman wants his disciplinary hearing. Head officer sending up a bigwig to pass judgment on him, poor devil.
Is he in serious trouble?
Oh, I think he is, yes. Anyway, down to our business. About this house of yours.
Oh, yes.
Well, having weighed things up, I fear I must revise my offer downwards. You know, it wants a lot doing.
Oh, no, look, I'm sorry, Reg.
Hmm?
Look, you made an offer, and I said yes. Well, back out. Feel free if you want. But I'm not haggling.
Come, Rita. One has to be flexible, you know. It's going to cost me a fortune to make that place habitable for Maureen's mother. I mean, it's a stirlift to start with, and then there's a horse
on the bottom.
You're having
a stirlift?
Yeah.
Oh, I just assumed you'd be turning the garage into a granny flat for her, because it's big enough. And, I mean, there's a door there already through from the kitchen.
Oh, my word, my word.
Pardon?
Hmm? Oh, look, forget I spoke. The offer still stands. Reg Holdsworth's word is his bond. You know that.
Well, time has not been wasted.
Oh, my. Do you know, I've been on that cheese counter all day. My
Maureen, I'm trying to tell you.
What? Do you know, I smell of cheese. I smell it when I'm in bed. Do you know, I dream of cheese.
Maureen.
What?
I have been to see Rita.
Well, I hope that's not a confession, Reg.
No, of course it's not a confession. I've been to see her about the house.
High Bank Avenue?
Yes, the same. And she was very reasonable. And I made my offer, which she accepted. And, well, it's ours as soon as we can get through the paperwork.
At long last, the big day arrived, and Reg found himself waiting nervously at the church.
Hey, that's it again.
What are you on about?
Just look at her. She keeps smiling at me, like she knows something I don't.
Don't be daft. She's smiling because you're the bridegroom. She's happy for you.
Happy for me, huh?
Sadly, she fought tooth and nail to put a stop to this wedding. She's not going to show. Let's go then. Hmm? Well, at least no more Watson's here, so she can't have eloped.
Yeah, girlie. Who's the fat bloke sitting next to Reg? Eric. He's the best man. I thought that was your job.
It was. I mean, I was going to. I mean, they asked me, but I said no. Work commitments, you know. I mean, it was touch and go. Will's going to make it at all today.
Is that Eric his brother or something then?
Nah. He runs a cash and carry in Salford. Reg hardly knows him.
I thought it was short of a few mates, I'd have volunteered myself.
It's not a question of being short of a few mates. He's currying favour with a valuable business associate.
You what?
Well, think about it, right? Reg has just bought Alf's.
So?
So, it's a cutthroat business, the grocery trade. To succeed, you need friends on the inside. What better way to get an in than to have your wholesaler as your best man?
Get away.
No, I mean it. The only reason you're here is because you're a potential customer. It's the same with the rest of the guests. This is not just a wedding, you know. It's a business launch.
Shush. Right, see ya.
There you are. Hey? I told you she'd show up.
Well, it's the first time I've rolled up at a wedding in one of these, I must say. And we're late. Everybody's going to turn around and stare at us.
Hey, listen, the way you look in that outfit, everybody's going to turn around and stare at it.
I hope that's a compliment.
Of course it is.
Oh!
Come on!
I, Reginald. Take thee, Maureen Elizabeth. To my wedded wife. To have and to hold. From this day forward. For better, for worse. For richer, for poorer. In sickness and in health. To love and to cherish. Till death us do part. According to God's holy law. And thereto I give thee my troth.
Ladies and gentlemen, squeeze it. Tighter. Ladies and gentlemen, bob down a little bit. Between the two gents. Yeah. Hold it. No. Thank you. one step forward. Touch it. Right. Hold it. Are you ready? Okay.
Now married, and with Maud seemingly resigned to the idea, there was just a reception to get through, and then they would be off on their honeymoon. Or so Reg thought.
But, alas, the first time round, the wedding never took place. Combination of circumstances and cruel hand of fate conspired to thwart us. And we went to separate ways, didn't we?
Yeah.
Anyway, both of us, I'm sad to say, made an unsuccessful foray into matrimony with other partners.
You can't go in the middle of this speech.
I've got to. I'm desperate.
But, as you can see, there is a happy ending to this little story. And a simple moral, too. If there's anybody here today who feels their life has been tainted by loneliness, anybody who feels that the chance of happiness has passed them by, don't give up hope. It's not too late for Cupid's arrow to strike, and it'll happen when you least expect it. Just as it was, after separation for 26 years...
25 years.
Eh? Sorry, 25 years of separation, Maureen walked through the doors of Better Buys and back into my life, where I hope that she'll stay for good. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Why should we be lumbered with Her Majesty? Hey, I mean, by rights, she should be with you and Peggy permanently.
There isn't the room.
Isn't the room? A five-bedroom note in Hermby, isn't it?
Four, five, four.
I mean, you're always going on about it, how big it is, and you're both retired. You've got the time to give Maud the care and attention she needs. But oh, no, 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 not you. Let Reg and Maureen shoulder the burden.
There's no call for that, Reg.
Truth be told, neither of us wants her. She belongs in a home.
You won't hear that, will you?
Well, I know. That's why we all had to take our fair share of the burden. Now, me and Peggy are happy to help out, but not full time. Anyway, she can't have that many years left in her.
We all... Of course she's all right. She's got what she wanted, hasn't she?
Oh, shut up, Reg.
I'll tell you something else.
What?
She won't be satisfied with sabotaging our honeymoon. From now on, you won't be able to move off the step without her say so.
I didn't sabotage anything.
That speaks, sir.
I just wanted to come home, that's all.
Yeah.
I heard them talking, the pair of them, saying what a burden I was and how I'd be better off in a home. Well, the only home I'm going in is this one.
Is this true, Reg?
Oh, we were having an hypothetical discussion, that's all. Weren't we, Gladly?
Oh, absolutely, Reg, absolutely.
And Dion had me dead and buried.
Reg, you are despicable. And after Mother had made a special effort to be nice to you. My God, the wedding day isn't even over yet. I'm already beginning to regret marrying you.
Hey, Maureen, no, come here.
Wait, go away.
Maureen, come here.
Come on, Mother. We'll do you some hot milk and get you settled down, eh?
I never meant to spoil her honeymoon, honestly, I didn't.
Yes, I know you didn't, Mother. I know you didn't.
Oh, come on, Maureen. What start to a marriage is this? This is our wedding night.
Don't remind me.
Oh, I was only sticking up for you, you know. Saying how unfair it was for you to shoulder all the burden.
My mother is not a burden.
No, no, of course she isn't. No, I don't mean burden. I mean responsibility. Anyway, you said to yourself how unfair it was. She's blown it all out of proportion, you know. You know what she's like. Oh. Look, Maureen, can't we just pretend all this never happened? I mean, it's been a marvellous day. The first day of what I sincerely believe to be a wonderful marriage. We've blown the honeymoon now, so can't we just try and at least to salvage something?
Come here.
Although they never got to Paris, they did manage a honeymoon of sorts in the lakes, and when everything was settled with the corner shop, the future looked rosy. But life with Mother was never going to be easy.
Oh, God. Hey, rolling the light mornings, eh? I hate feeling like I'm getting up in the middle of the night.
Oh, it's just the middle of the night. Can you voice sound, because you're waiting Mother.
Wait, your Mother?
Yeah.
You must be joking. She's been up all night. I've heard her. Been up and down like a yo-yo.
Well, she can't help it ever since she had a prolapse. Hey, and just be careful of that tap. Oh!
What? Oh, here we go. The beast stirs.
Oh, don't be nasty. She's been very accommodating to you. She's gone out of her way to make you able to feel at home.
Ah, well, I suppose you're right. I'm going to put that on.
Listen, Reg.
What?
Do we have to get up at this time every morning? I'm shattered.
Well, I'm afraid so, Maureen.
Oh.
I mean, if you want also to be a purveyor of fruit and vegetables, fresh fruit and vegetables, it means you and me getting up at the crack of dawn and going to buy them, doesn't it?
I know, but listen. Mm-hmm. Couldn't we just, you know, take it in turns? And then one of us would have a lie-in.
A lie-in?
Yeah.
A lie-in?
Yeah.
Oh, the days of lying-in have gone. Mm. We're open 7 days, remember?
Don't remind me.
Yeah, this is a life at the sharp end, is this? Not for us, the cosseted world of the retail monolith.
Oh.
Eh? Be no more skiving off. Taking dubious sick leave, abdicating responsibilities. Oh, no. From now on, the buck stops with yours truly.
Oh,
but it won't go on forever. Oh. One day, when the halls of the empire are spread far and wide, me and you will spend our lives lounging beside some pool on the Algarve. Nearest thing to work we'll do is, well, message to UK, see what the figures are, and of course the odd occasional branch visit to boost staff morale.
Reg, such naked ambition.
Oh, no, I don't care, me.
Oh, hello, Mother. Sorry, did we wait you?
I was only half asleep anyway. I'm going to have to see Dr. Hughes. I'm doubled up in pain.
Well, the kettle's on there. Shall I make you a nice cup of tea?
No, I'll do that. I like to do my bit. I want to make sure you both have a cooked breakfast. There's plenty of eggs and bacon in the fridge.
Oh, don't think so, Mother.
What about Reginald?
Oh, no, thank you no more. No, it's too early for me.
Oh, well, please yourself. A good breakfast sets you up for the day ahead.
Oh.
That's what your father always used to say. Here, Maureen. Hmm? Did I hear you shouting out in the night?
No, Mother.
I'm sure I did. More than once. I nearly came through.
You must have been imagining it, Mother.
I definitely heard shouting. Perhaps you were having a bad dream.
Perhaps, yeah.